everyone. My name is Sarah, and for my paper, for my healthcare comparison paper, I'm going to be discussing the differences in Canada's healthcare system as opposed to the differences in the United States' healthcare system. And based off of my paper, as well as the PowerPoint presentation I made that you'll see, I kind of tried to make the PowerPoint as sequential as I could and as reflective of my paper as possible. So that's what I'm just going to give a little explanation as to how I kind of set up the PowerPoint, because that's what you're going to be mainly looking at. So from the beginning, I just did the title, and then from the introduction, I just kind of explained how the United States and Canada, their healthcare systems are systems that reflect, you know, an advanced industrialized nation, a first world country, and they're facing a lot of the controversies that, you know, many first world nations face. And besides the United States and Canada, there are other countries that probably face the same problems, but I thought it was important to distinguish the fact that a lot of other countries like India or Africa, they may not be facing the same problems, and they might not be, you know, enforcing the same healthcare policies as well as just dealing with the same problems. So, I just kind of described that in the introduction, as well as how the healthcare policies, they're different as well as the same within both of the countries. They vary, but at its core, a lot of it is the same. And I hit on maybe 4 or 5 main points when talking about the United States and Canada, because I did it in my paper. I talked about the United States first and then Canada. For the most part, I talked mostly about, like, the 4 main points, I'd say, are like the healthcare insurance coverage in both, the roles of the providers and like the competition within healthcare, how that varies between the two, the types of care that you receive based off of the healthcare policy or insurance plan that you might have in both, and then the delivery of the care. So who is going to be giving you the care? So and if you go to the 3rd slide, that talks about my introduction, which is what I was just talking about. And then if you go into the 4th slide, it's going to go into the history of the United States healthcare system. I did that as well as I did the history of the Canada's healthcare system, because I thought it was important to kind of establish where they were at one point and how it's progressed and evolved to what it is today. So if you go on to slide 4. It's going to talk about the history of the United States healthcare system, and I pretty much paraphrased it as much as I could based off of my paper. And I just kind of talked about how before modern medicine, before it existed within the United States or even in Canada, a lot of the healthcare services were very unregulated. Medical coverage wasn't something that was talked about because they didn't have a lot of knowledge and expertise on just medicine in general. So a lot of the practices then were a lot more unorthodox than they are now. Doctors, or, you know, I don't even think they were considered doctors at that point. They would treat patients in their homes, and they would use remedies and treatments that we would never use today because of modern medicine and because of, you know, medications and antibiotics and all everything that we have nowadays. It's very different from then. So, you know, they could only offer minimal care. They didn't have the options that we do today. So I thought that was important to establish if we're talking about the healthcare system in the 21st century. I thought it was also important to mention that back then, even to now, as time has progressed and healthcare was established, patients did a lot of times, even back then, and still today, from what I've even seen from personal experience, they're more worried about a lot of times how they're gonna pay for a lot of the treatments that they're getting, rather than their health. They're not putting their health first. They're putting, you know, what's going to happen after I leave the hospital or I leave the clinics? You know, how is this going to affect my day-to-day life? Because that is a huge problem. So I also mentioned that when talking about the history of it, of the U.S. healthcare system. And then I also talked about how, like, the establishment and membership into the American Medical Association kind of changed the way we looked at medicine. And in a lot of ways, it increased, like, medical education among a lot of the students and everything. There were stricter requirements to get into medical school. The curriculum changed and it became a lot more difficult. And just the standards rose and they were tougher and they were better, you know. as time went on and everything. So as the quality of care increased, obviously the cost increased as well, and a lot of establishments of like different insurance plans and different coverage plans came about from that. So I also talked about that. And then if you go on to the fifth slide, I went into the history of Canada's healthcare system. Now this is a little different than from what my paper was, because I began to talk about the United States and I talked about the history, and then I went through the healthcare system throughout the United States. So I didn't do it like this on the PowerPoint slide, but I figured I would just kind of get the histories out of the way in the beginning and then go into the actual differences. So I talked about the history of the Canada's healthcare system as well. I described in my PowerPoint, as long as in my paper, that the Canadian Constitution played a huge role from the beginning of like the healthcare system and how it was established and everything. And how, like, the powers of three different types of government, the federal, provincial, and the territorial governments, how they were established in the Constitution back in the 1800s, and how different healthcare policies were kind of split up between those three. And each branch of those governments in Canada, they kind of established their control, and, like, they were responsible for certain policies that were being enforced and everything. In my slide, I talked about how the territorial and the provincial, I don't know if I'm saying that right, those two governments, they were more grouped together than the federal, and they took on the majority of the responsibility when it came to, like, healthcare and, like, providing, like, the social services that, you know, people needed in the community, like the public health services and everything, dealing with, like, sanitation, infectious diseases, and like educating people based off of those. So that was an important point to make. And then I also talked about how the federal government, their responsibilities, they were more of like the financial aspect of it. They were providing the coverage, the financial support, basically. They were providing the financial support to the other two types of government. So they were kind of providing the money, and like how all of this was being funded was through the federal government. And because they were funding it, they were more responsible for like the policies, like the health protection, the regulations, the research that was done. And then the other two types were more of the enforcing parties of it. So that was kind of like, I thought that was important to mention, because it does definitely vary from our, like the United States' healthcare system. We don't, you know, function that way. So that the history of that is pretty important. So I thought that was important to note. And then if you go in slides 6 through 9, those were probably the four main points that I talked about the most in my paper. So the first one was on slide 6, the healthcare insurance coverage. So in the United States, the United States, they're required to fund their own healthcare insurance. And then, you know, they could, they didn't have to fund it if, like, they could qualify for Medicare or Medicaid or whatever, but that was important that they had to fund their own. Canada, they had a national healthcare system, so it's universal. They all get them, so that there's a big difference there. And the next one, the roles of the providers and the competition within healthcare. In the United States, private enterprises, they were more of, like, the primary providers, so like, the insurers, the insurance companies, they were privately functioning, and they would compete for customers. They would offer, you know, they offer benefit packages to a lot of different companies. So if you work for that company, you get certain options for coverage plans, and then you choose that based off of how much money you want to give every month to those coverage plans. And then that's the kind of coverage you're going to get, whether it's medical, dental, you know, accidental, life, whatever it is, short-term disability, long-term disability. So a lot of times the healthcare providers, the private insurers, they would compete for consumers, like an employee. The insurance companies could just directly reach to individuals, though, as well, so that's important to note. And then in Canada, most of the healthcare services, they're provided by, like, private providers. So the doctors and physicians, they work privately. They work for private hospitals, private healthcare organizations. And instead of, like, the providers being paid by the insurance companies, they're paid by the government. So because Canada has a national and a universal healthcare system, because everybody gets coverage, they were paid more from the government. And then, like, the healthcare providers in the United States, they're paid from the insurance companies. So that's different. You know, that's a big difference. The types of care, that was my third point. In the United States, healthcare coverage, it varies depending on the type, like I said, the type of benefit package you have based off of how much money you're willing to give to those benefit plans every pay period, every paycheck. That's going to reflect the kind of care you're going to get a lot of times. The more money you're willing to spend, the better your options are for your benefits, for your health insurance, everything like that. There was a Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act that was put into place in 2010, so there are minimal coverages that everybody has to be guaranteed with, you know, healthcare, with like that insurance. So that was important. That was an important part of, United States healthcare. And then in Canada does have a universal healthcare. So they provide coverage for all Canadian citizens, but of course that sounds great. They definitely limit it though. So, the coverage that they're provided, they're going to be provided care if they need to go to a hospital and they need care from a medical provider. They're not going to get all of their prescriptions for free. They're not going to get, you know, everything for free. So there's definitely a limit onto it, but there is a universal system so everybody gets care. So it's kind of like a balance. So there is a limit in Canada. The services that aren't necessarily the services that aren't, like, included are, like, they're not required to offer them, or, like, prescriptions, long-term care, dental, vision. Those are all things that provinces aren't, you know, they're not required to offer everybody. So that was an important point to make as well. And then the delivery of primary care was my fourth difference between the two systems. In the United States, primary care physicians, they're like the PCPs, that's what's the abbreviation, they account for 1/3 of all U.S. doctors. And patients do have a free choice of doctor, but within their healthcare insurance plan, they're going to be given those options based off of what doctors are covered under their plan. They don't get to choose any doctor that they want. So the physicians are usually paid through the private insurers. That's the agreement that they make. And then the patients, you know, part of the plan, you know, if you've ever heard of a copay, you're responsible somewhat for some of the payment. You're not going to pay the full price, but you will usually have to pay like a copay at the end of whatever visit, if you go to a clinic or a doctor's office or whatever. So you're going to have to pay something. It just might not be as much as if you didn't have insurance. And then in Canada, half of the practicing physicians, they're general practitioners. So there's a difference. General practitioners in Canada and then primary care physicians in U.S., in the United States. So it's just different. It varies. And then patients, they have a free choice for their primary care doctor. They can choose whoever they want based off of where they're living and everything. They can't just choose somebody on the opposite side of the country. So that's limited. And then I said that patients aren't directly responsible for physician payment because physicians are paid through the universal healthcare plan, so through the government. So that was another point to make. That, you know, a lot of times you don't think about that in like the United States. That's unheard of. The government paying your bills and everything like that. So then in the conclusion, I just basically talked about how in both differing societies, it makes sense why the different healthcare policies exist, because there are differing nations. And what might work for one country might not work for another country. And the society that you live in that's going to determine the kind of policies that you live and what the government establishes as what you're going to live by. You know, that's going to vary big, like country to country. So obviously every policy that exists within that is going to vary as well. But there are similarities at the core, at the principle of any kind of policy. There are, you know, basic principles that every policy is going to go by. And two specific similarities between both were like consumer protection. That's a big priority for both, even though they do have differing ways of doing things. That's always a goal. And then recognizing that there's competition within a healthcare system, and that's the way that a healthcare system flourishes and everything. That was another important part. And so that was pretty much it. Thank you for watching.